Very good morning for everyone. It's just a pleasure to be amongst you, among the distinguished speakers and the awardees as well from yesterday. And also I would like to thank Professor Nurchi for that kind introduction. Also thank the organizers and Sheikh Hamdan Medical Sciences for giving this opportunity to talk about our experiences. Now, I didn't expect this to come this way because I'm following my colleague who did a fantastic presentation. It was Professor Gule. I thought it might be easier given that the age difference, but now that we're competing each other, but thank you. I'll hope that I'll keep up to that expectation as Dahlia has mentioned. Now, I would like to take it slightly differently, my presentation, because I've got two children and I start to tell story quite a lot. And I'd like to take through a journey here about our experience about this balloon-assisted enteroscopy. Does it move on this? Is there a pointer? Sorry, it's just technical things. I'm not used to this. Okay, there we go. Hopefully it works. I might end up here itself. We're stuck. All right, yeah, thank you. Okay, thank you. Sorry about this. So I would like to just show this is our new Sheffield Children's Hospital. Of course, it's Christmas. It looks very beautiful. And this is how we traveled. If somebody doesn't know about Sheffield, where it exists, it's in the small town in England, in Yorkshire. It is a beautiful part because it is part of the National Peak District. And we've got the highest number of trees to the individual ratio. And this is how it looks, beautiful. It's very panoramic. It has got a lot of trees, as I mentioned. And then the one thing I was thinking about to tell about Sheffield was about this. If you can remember, at the end of my presentation, what is all about Sheffield is, this is what we gave to the world. It's about the steel, iron and steel. This is the mass production, how it all evolved before we lost out in 1960s. And then Sheffield is known for its university, which is top 10. And this is our tallest building in Sheffield. And I'm sure you don't want to compare that to your ones. And there is a saying in Bible that if you have 40 days of rain, then you call that as a disaster, and we call that as summer. So pediatric gastroenterology team, we are 7 pediatric gastroenterology consultants, we soon will be 8, and then we got a lot of team of 30 to 35, including research and medical treatment launch. Now, we call this the endoscopy of the future, but this is what we are working in at the moment. So as I said, I like to talk about the story. So I talk about the future of human exploration. Now, I like this 20th century great poet, English British poet Eliot, who says, "We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time." Now, 1492, Columbus brought about the European colonization, conquest, and civilization. First man to land on the North Pole, Hansen, and then the conquest of Mount Everest. A small step for man, a big giant leap for human mankind, and then the Mars exploration. But it may not be, in my opinion, it is true for this city too. And then, of course, we are here in 2001, where we feel that we are at the final frontier. It might be a decade, and it's a long time for people from Dubai, because in 10, 15 years, you change the whole city. But for pediatric endoscopists to perform a deep enteroscopy is a significant challenge. And I still believe that is our final frontier. And it's a dream for us to visualize the whole of the small bowel. Now, if you look at this timeline here, what you could see is that in 1977, although we've been doing some endoscopies prior to that, from the enteroscopy perspective, looking at the small bowel, it started 30 years ago in 1977 when Tata introduced these sonde enteroscopes, and since then there has been evolution of various enteroscopes. Now, I'm sure in adults there has a lot of publications about double balloon enteroscopy, but we have a lot of difficulties in pediatric population. because it's not just because of the length of the small bowel or the tortuosity, but it's because about the training, the skill handsets. It's pretty difficult. It requires a high expertise. Of course, the instruments. It's not pediatric instruments. It's not FDA approved, so we have to use the adult instruments, and that itself brings about a lot of challenges. And the cost of that is significantly high. And let's not talk about the procedural time and success. It's even harder. Now, as I mentioned earlier, sonde-type endoscope, it's nothing but just a long enteroscope, which has got a balloon at the tip of it. There's minimal pediatric experience in 3 patients, but has a and it mainly moves by peristalsis and drugs, and there was no working channel and had a prolonged examination time. Then came along the push enteroscopy, which is again a standard enteroscope with an overtube. So we will come back to the animation later to show what the overtube looks like. And there is only one single report. Decent length of insertion, about 130 centimeters post-pylorus, and had a good diagnostic yield with no complications. Now, I would like to show this wireless capsule endoscopy. This came along in 2001, where you introduce, if the children are able to swallow, a big capsule of paracetamol, or otherwise it will be put under general anesthetic with a special introducer. And this capsule goes along the whole of the small bowel. It takes about seven to eight hours. Captures 50 to 60,000 images, and that will be analyzed on a software by ourselves to identify. In 85 to 90%, we can obtain a report on those techniques. So that came along, and we can do it up to the from the age of 18 months. We can start doing the wireless capsule endoscopy. Then came along the double balloon endoscopy around the same time, 2001, by Yamamoto, who's a pioneer, and which was manufactured by Fujinon, by the Japanese group. Now, this is how it looks, where if you look at the endoscopes, there is an overtube and an endoscope with the 2 balloons you could see, one on the endoscope at the tip, and one on the overtube, and with the balloon at the end of it. And then there's a processor, and you could see a balloon pump and a remote control to inflate and deflate the balloon. And let's look at the animation. It looks pretty easy on this one, but believe me, it's pretty hard to perform this procedure. So you do as normally with an endoscope. So you insert the endoscope, get to the stomach, then keep going to the third part of the duodenum. Inflate the balloon, which will hold the small intestine there, and then the overtube moves along. Then again, you inflate the balloon of the overtube. Deflate now the balloon of the endoscope, push forwards, inflate the balloon. And similarly, now you're gonna deflate the overtube balloon and again inflate. I think this is the key step now, that what happens now. When you're pulling it back, you could see that pleating of the bowel over the overtube, what we call as the concentric circles or the concertina. And this way, you continue of inflation and deflation over the time, and you will be able to traverse the whole of the small bowel. So that's pretty much the technique per se. You can perform that by either a transoral route or you could do with the transanal route or the retrograde approach. So you do both the top and the bottom. Now, bit of a technical, but I would not go in detail about that, but I would like to highlight those on the red that there are 2 types of scopes. One is a P scope and another one is a T scope. P is for the diagnostic, T is for the therapeutic. But you can imagine if the overtube, the diameter of that is 13.2 millimeters. That is a massive tube it's adult. And as Dali was mentioning earlier, you would require at least 6 millimeters or 8 millimeters endoscope, but we are working with 13.2 millimeter scopes in children. So that itself brings about a lot of difficulties in that one. Now, in 2010, we published a feasibility study after obtaining research ethical approval. And since then, there are a number of publications, but as you could see, it's a small, but certainly an increasing number of publications over the time. Then we published our diagnostic and therapeutic utility of double balloon endoscopy in children, which is the largest. Of course, I showed you the children's hospital, Sheffield, is not a big city. We got a small catchment area, but we've been lucky enough to get referrals from wider part of the country and also abroad as well. And of course, this is the slide that I did in 2014-15, so we've gone on further with our learning curve and referrals too. Now, in our experience, between 2008, 2009, and 2014, we had about 58 children who had 113 examination, which had both top and the bottom. 36 children were boys, and the median age was 12.7. Median weight was 38 kilos, with the smallest being 8 kilos. Now, so when we look at the transoral approach, we call that as a pass. If you could imagine that when we pull, insert and deflate it and pull the back, we call that each time you do that, we call it a pass. So we were able to do 15 passes. It's a rough estimate as what each pass is. We consider that it's about 30 centimeters on the transoral route, but if on the transanal route, we call it about 20 centimeters. So it's just an estimate. There is no way that I could prove or impossible to say exactly what length we have traversed. And you could see the median insertion length was 230 centimeters. And if you can imagine, the small bowel length in a little baby's would be about 250 to 300 centimeters. In a bigger kids or adults or adolescents, it can be up to 4.5 to 5 meters. So, you know, median insertion length was about 230. And the median examination time, it's about 80 minutes. It's quite a long time. If you think about it, I mean, we finish colonoscopes in about 20 minutes, so 80 minutes is a significant time. Of course, we were able to do it on a little baby who was 12 months old of 8 kilos. And the transanal approach, we had about 7 passes, median incision length was 80 centimeters. It's not as good as the transoral because of the difficulties to get through the IC valve and going further up, so it has got its own limitations over there. And median examination time was 40 minutes for this, and we call it panenteroscopy. When we're able to visualize the whole of the small bowel, we call it panenteroscopy. And it was in about 30% of the times we were able to visualize the whole of the small bowel. Now, what was the main indications? Main indications, of course, was mainly polyps, polyposis syndrome. This is a polyp in a Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. We had Cowden's and blue rubber bleb syndrome and familial adenomatous polyposis. In about 16 children, it was for obscure GI bleeding, erosions, and ulcers with angiodysplasias being the commoner, with one patient with gastric varices per se. And in about 8 children, we did perform for suspected Crohn's disease. And also in some cases, we did on established cases, but when we wanted to change the management, we did use the double balloon enteroscope. Protein lutein enteropathy in about 5 children. We did able to change the management and help the management of these children. Refractory Crohn's disease with jejunitis, we were able to identify and manage this. And other indications were chronic abdominal pain. I said small bowel obstruction, but it was a pseudo obstruction, and there were other 2 cases of vomiting of unknown cause. Now, look at this diagnostic yield. I mean, this is fairly good. If you compare that, the wireless capsule endoscopy, which is a non-invasive, it can provide about 77% as a diagnostic yield. And the double balloon, we were able to have about 70%, which is fairly good. And what it led to the management is in about 73%, we were able to change the management in those children. Now, I would like to, I know Dahlia showed some lovely videos. This is the utility of a double balloon enteroscopy in a small bowel. You can imagine this can't be accessed by a simple endoscope, or children are so small that it has to be more invasive, like having a laparotomy to take out these polyps. And sometimes it's not just a polyp. It can be many number of polyps. The number of polypectomies we've done is about 60 to 70. So in one patient, we have many numbers, so which means that if you end up doing intraoperative, then you're taking the whole of the small bowel. So I hope you appreciate that, you know, this technique is useful in certain indication that it is for. And this is what is an argon plasma coagulation. This was a patient with ileocolonic anastomosis. This is the anastomotic site where there was ulcers, and the patient had iron deficiency anemia due to the recurrent bleeding from that end. And so we were successful enough to be able to use this argon plasma coagulation. And then this was another very interesting patient where presented with iron deficiency anemia, unresponsive to iron therapy. And so we did the upper GI endoscopy, ileum colonoscopy. We didn't identify anything. Then we did a capsule enteroscopy, but the capsule never came out. And we were wondering where the capsule had gone. So we went with the enteroscope, and you could see that there, that is pretty tiny. That is a very, very narrow stricture. And this is what the level of playing field for us. You know, this is just an injection of methylene blue to just under the mucosa. And you could see pretty much the needle is coming out on the other end. And that is where we will be working the playing field. So it's a very risky it could end up the other side as well. So that is just to help our surgeons that where we have been so that they can come along and do the procedure as well. So this is what we found. You see there? That was a capsule which was there. We had missed. Family didn't identify that. And then we were able to retrieve that by using a rot net. The people who did my workshop yesterday, we showed the rot net, so the domia basket, we were able to take it out by using this technique as well. So there has been benefits on that. And this is what we call as a lap-assisted double balloon enteroscopy, where the laparoscopic approach, you could see there from the laparoscopic end how the concertine is happening. The concentric circles are happening over the overtube balloon. So that's just an image that you could see from the inside. Now, we saw that there was a good diagnostic yield, but of course, we also had a very good therapeutic yield. We were able to give endotherapy in about 47% of the time. Of course, we had a steep learning curve too. Let's not forget the complications. We ended up with this. You could see there's a hole. You could see the peritoneum through the hole. And this was on a small bowel transplant patient which presented with a GI bleed. And it's an afferent loop. It was a diseased patient as well. So it is a very sicky patient which we took this procedure. And of course, he ended up with a perforation. We tried to put all the clips, but none of them really worked. Eventually, he ended up having a laparotomy and closure of that perforation. Now, this is what has been reported in the literature, and the Nishimura group from the Japanese, they are the pioneers. So initially, Yamamoto group, who has got 48 children, but their indications were a lot different to ours because their indications were mainly post-liver transplantation. But our group is the largest at the moment, reported in literature, and also that if you look at the depth of insertion, it's about, we achieved in about 30% enteroscopy with the. And the complication rate is no different to the adults. When you do the 5% is pretty much comparable to the adult as well. So in a sense that it is a safe technique. So just to catch up with few other balloon-assisted enteroscopies, there is something called as single balloon enteroscopy, which has been developed by the Oshuka group developed by Olympus. Again, if you look at this, basically, it works by not the tip of the balloon, but it has got slightly over, but it mainly works by the angling the tip of the endoscope and holding that and helping moving forward. But I think the benefit of single balloon is it's a single person compared to double balloon endoscopy. Sometimes when we are performing, I'll be doing right at the front, and my colleague, which I'll show you the picture, Mike Thompson will be standing outside the room because it's quite long tube. It's a 2.5 meters. So it is quite a spectacle to watch when double balloon endoscopy is happening, quite a lot of people around as well. But you could see the benefit is that we can achieve total endoscopy with a double balloon, not with the single balloon. But there's not much difference in the diagnostic yield. Then came along this spiral enteroscopy. There is no evidence or experience of using in children, but has been more so in adults. And the benefit of that is it is like a screw, like a spiral that keeps screwing around and going. There's an overtube and goes along with the clockwise rotation of the overtube. But I think the only benefit of spiral at the moment, as far as I understand, is that it takes a lesser procedural time, but it is only antegrade. You can't screw from the bottom. Sorry, it's mainly antegrade. And this is something called as a NaviAide. I mean, as I mentioned, there is a it is quite expensive tool to obtain double balloon endoscopy, but I think there's the new innovations coming up with these guys, which is works like a double balloon, but it is called NaviAide, which is cheaper and can be used on a normal endoscope. So you don't have to change your scopes or anything. You don't have to spend a length of time preparing. It's pretty easy. And you could see the animation. It works very much similar, but it is extremely cheap compared to the double balloon. Now, I mentioned about the complications. Abdominal pain is something that adults have reported. We don't have seen much in our because we use CO2, which absorbs pretty quickly, and we don't see the abdomen dissection and problems with that. And I mentioned that with the diagnostic double balloon endoscopy, we have a complication rate of 1.7, which is comparable to the adults. And this is the adult quoted as well. The therapeutic DBE, they had about 4.3%, which is as well as. Now, I would just to conclude before I summarize that balloon-assisted endoscopy is a preferred modality for lesions identified on capsule endoscopy. All our patients had had capsule, they identified the lesions, then we did the double-blind enteroscopy. Enteroscopy is safe for all endotherapeutic applications. And hopefully, over the time, with the evolution of accessories and advances in balloon-assisted enteroscopy, we will be able to facilitate a better diagnosis and management of small bowel lesions. Results of different enteroscopies are yet to be revealed by future clinical trials. So we have no idea whether single is better, double is better, or spiral. At the moment, all are reasonable good enough. It depends on the expertise and the training. Now, this is American Society of Gastroenterological Society who have laid down this position paper, if one is interested, and their recommendations from them is that balloon endoscopy is effective, safe, DBE is most effective technique for total endoscopy, you should perform capsule as your first line investigations, and balloon assisted is very good for tissue diagnostic and therapeutics, and of course need to be considered in Crohn's disease. Now, this is a food for thought, that where we go from here. What's the future? I said I'll come back to my story, so what's the future? So hopefully, this is what the future is, I think, which is all the robots. Hopefully, the robots also has got hands as well to them. We don't want just a capsule to go. We want hands. What hopefully, they'll go take the biopsies and also direct the treatment of where the lesions are, as in this case. So again, with that future, where next? And again, I go back to my great one of the poet. It says, only those who will risk going too far can possibly find out how far one can go. And with that, as Dali was mentioning, we are one of the endoscopic training centers, and that's my colleague. And this presentation wouldn't be, I wouldn't be standing here. This is my guru, my mentor, my supervisor, Mike Thompson, and I would like to thank everyone for kind listening. Thank you.